Isaiah's prophecy, the 11th chapter, beginning at verse 1. A shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse, and from his roots a branch will bear fruit. The Spirit of the Lord will rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and of understanding, the Spirit of counsel and of might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, and he will delight in the fear of the Lord. He will not judge by what he sees with his eyes or decide by what he hears with his ears, but with righteousness he will judge the needy. With justice he will give decisions for the poor of the earth. He will strike the earth with the rod of his mouth. With the breath of his lips he will slay the wicked. And righteousness will be his belt, and faithfulness the sash around his waist. And the wolf will live with the lamb. The leopard will lie down with the goat. The calf and the lion and the yearling together. And a little child will lead them. The cow will feed with the bear. Their young will lie down together. And the lion will eat straw like the ox. The infant will play near the cobra's den. And the young child will put its hand into the viper's nest. But neither there will be harm nor destruction on all my holy mountain, for the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. In that day, the root of Jesse will stand as a banner for all the people. The nations will rally to him, and his resting place will be glorious. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. I don't know if many of you remember the song, Good Night, Irene. If you've ever sung the song, you know that it's not exactly a happy tune or with happy words. The tune might be more happier than the words. Actually, it was first recorded by the American blues musician Huddy Leadbelly Ledbetter in 1933 to deal with his sadness over losing his girlfriend, Irene. Huddy Leadbetter was in that dreaded Louisiana State Penitentiary, otherwise known as the Plantation or as the Farm or simply as Angola, on the banks of the muddy Mississippi, surrounded by bayous. Indeed, it was a bad place, and he had lost his dear Irene. He had given up hope and he had no peace. The word Irene is an interesting word. Unlike many of our words, the name Irene, letter for letter, comes from Greek. Irene is how we might pronounce it if we were speaking Greek, but it's spelled with the same letters. Transposing the English alphabet for the Greek alphabet, It's spelled exactly the same, and Irene, or Irene, means peace. So when Leadbetter said goodbye, Irene, or good night, Irene, he was saying so long, peace. And some of us have felt that way. We've thought about those who lost their lives in Pensacola. Terrorism, once again, strikes close to home. We've thought about all the different events that have taken place. We're worried about the North Koreans and their missile tests. We're worried about Iran and what they might do to upset a tenuous peace, if you can call it that, in the Middle East. We worry about worry, it seems. And we have no peace. Indeed, peace has been an elusive thing since Adam and Eve, or especially since Cain and Abel. Of the past 3,450 years of recorded human history, we've only been entirely at peace as a human race for just 268 years. Only 8% of all of history has been a time of peace. Would it be wonderful if we would be used to this lack of peace? but we long for it. Isaiah longed for it. He lived in a day and age when the people of Israel had been attacked over 40 years, back and forth, back and forth. Five different times, the armies of the Assyrian Empire and sometimes occasionally the Egyptian Empire ran rampant and ravaged the land and the people of Israel, the people of God. So for 40 straight years, the people of God underwent turmoil and a lack of peace. And so it's interesting, in the middle of this passage of Scripture, we hear about peace, though it wasn't really a time of peace. And he gives this beautiful description and says, the wolf will live with the lamb, the leopard will lie down with the goat, the calf and the lion and the yearling together, and a little child will lead them, and the cow will feed with the bear, and it goes on and on. And it gives this beautiful description of peace. And this peace is foretold even a few chapters earlier in chapter 9, where it says there, unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called, and you know the words, he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. But it goes even further. It says, of the greatness of his government and his peace, there will be no end. So even with all the drama in Washington, D.C., we can look to one who comes from this stump of Jesse. Jesse and his seven sons, one of whom was David, anointed to be king. And one in his line, one of his descendants, even Jesus the Christ, will bring this peace and fulfill it, we pray, in our day. Indeed, we long for peace. But we find ourselves too often worried about a lack of peace. Some of you went through Thanksgiving, and there were persons there, perhaps, who typically get your goat, if you know what I mean. And they'll be back for Christmas. I read about two sisters. One's name was Charlotte. She was sort of the irreligious one in the family. And her sister Letty, who had more religion than she really needed, if that can be the case. And so Charlotte says to her sister Letty, "Old woman, you just don't thump the Bible at me. You beat it like a drum." And then Letty says back to her, "That's because along with being hard-headed, you're apparently hard of hearing." And then Charlotte pushed off her rocker so hard that it slammed against the wall. Nothing irritated her any more than somebody trying to shove religion down her throat, and no one in her mind carried a bigger shovel than her sister Letty. Charlotte flared, "You Christians are like fleas, impossible to get rid of and irritating as all get out." And then Letty said smugly, "Well, on Judgment Day, I have no doubt that the burn will take your mind off the itch." Now, rest assured, I would assume that most psychologists would say that it wasn't religion that really started their row with each other. There was something else that had occurred along the way. Perhaps one of them got a special doll at Christmas that the other really wanted, and there was a mix-up. Perhaps it was a boyfriend or something else along the way. Usually the things that get us most upset have nothing to do with the presenting problem. It's just the latest in a long series. So Isaiah longed for peace. Inner peace, personal peace, international peace, peace for the nation, and gives us this beautiful picture. But it's a picture. How do we make it a reality? Well, I had one of those persons at Thanksgiving. You know, it's my brother-in-law. He's a Baptist preacher. And that's not really the big issue. My father, after all, was Baptist before becoming a Methodist. Baptists make great Methodists. Guilt goes a long way. I've got a niece over there shaking her finger at me. Baptists do make great Methodists, and nevertheless, sometimes my Baptist preacher brother-in-law, you know, our religion couldn't be further apart. And it's not because he's Baptist, it's because he doesn't really believe in the resurrection of the dead. And I don't know how you can be a preacher and not believe in the resurrection of the dead. I mean, we've got all sorts of difficulties in our relationship. So we can't talk about religion. And he pulls for a football team that I wouldn't give the time of day. And I'm not even talking about Clemson. So we can't talk about religion. We can't talk about football. And then it gets worse. He's 6'4" and has hollow legs, and once he gets in line in front of you, in front of everybody, he eats everything. And then if you bring up politics, their bumper stickers offend me. I have never voted for anybody they have ever voted for. And I say that proudly. So we all got together for Thanksgiving. And Cindy had warned me, try to be nice this year. Try to be nice this year. And so, semi-supergluing, don't try this at home, semi-supergluing my lips together, I faded off into the sunset of the living room and even pulled up a purple, my Clemson graduate son's throw over me so I could just have peace. And get this blessed brother-in-law comes over to me as they're about to exit the door and says, I'm sorry you weren't feeling well. My attempt at being a peacemaker resulted in, I'm sorry you weren't feeling well. Christmas is coming. What do we do? What do we do? What do we do to fulfill this prophecy of Isaiah? Clearly, we need the Prince of Peace. If it weren't for Jesus, well, we'd all go to the bad place and we wouldn't need an overcoat. We need Jesus' grace and love for all persons. We need grace and love for all persons. Jesus practiced that kind of forgiveness that did not require people to grovel and say they were sorry. I mean, Jesus, he looked down at the man who had been lured by his four friends through the roof of the place where Jesus was preaching and teaching. And Jesus looked down at the man paralyzed on the mat and said, son, your sins are forgiven. Take up your mat and walk. There's no evidence in the scripture that the boy ever asked to be forgiven. Jesus just simply forgave. Or the woman who had been caught in a compromising situation. There's no evidence in the scripture that she asked to be forgiven, and yet Jesus looked at her in the midst of these others who were ready to cast their stones. Jesus looked at her and said, daughter, your sins are forgiven. Go and sin no more. She didn't ask to be forgiven, but yet Jesus forgave. Or when Jesus was hanging upon the cross, he looked down and said those words we all know, we all remember, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. Wouldn't it be wonderful if we just forgave like that? Rather than waiting for my brother-in-law to say he's sorry. Wouldn't it be wonderful for us to just live a life of grace and forgiveness? Wouldn't it be wonderful? Often there's a lack of peace in our world. There's a story I conclude with. A sparrow asked a wild dove this question one day. Tell me the weight of a single snowflake. Tell me the weight of a single snowflake, the sparrow asked the wild dove. And the wild dove answered, nothing more than nothing. In that case, I must tell you a marvelous story, the sparrow said. I sat on a branch of a fir tree close to its trunk when it began to snow. Not heavily, not a giant blizzard, just a gentle, beautiful snow. And since I didn't have anything better to do, I counted the snowflakes settling on the twigs and needles of my branch. Their number was exactly 3,741,952. And when the next snowflake dropped onto the branch, nothing more than nothing, as you say, the branch broke off. And having said that, the sparrow flew away. And the dove thought about the story for a while and finally said to herself, perhaps there is only one voice lacking for peace to come into our world. Let us pray. Gracious God, help us to know that that voice is our voice. And that voice might simply be a voice that says, I love you, or I forgive you. It might be a voice that says, I understand. It might be a voice that doesn't even include words. It may just be a sympathetic look or a smile. Lord Jesus, we pray for peace in our world. We pray for peace in our families. We pray for peace in Jesus' name. Amen.